start of a new football season always holds the hope and promise of something new. Every team starts the year with a perfect record, but only the elite finish the regular season undefeated, and only one team dominated the nation's best 1AA football conference in 1995. Jerry Moore's Mountaineer squad that ended the regular season with a perfect 11-0 record began the year with a tough test against ACC foe Wake Forest. Appalachian scooted out to an early lead behind the strong running and leadership of senior Scott Satterfield, who almost didn't get the chance.
When the injury I had, the freak injury I had on my hand with the 20 stitches, and I got kind of worried that I wasn't going to get to play. I've been here, 5 years, and I still haven't played against Wake Forest, and that's one thing that I wanted to do really bad, and luckily, it healed up well enough so I could play, and I just wanted to go in there and just play the best I could. I mean, it was close to my hometown. I had a lot of fans there as well as everybody on this team, and that was a big game.
The Mountaineers were close to unstoppable in the first half, amassing 187 yards on the ground and another 52 through the air.
Now back in the pocket. Has some pressure, fires it out. Alvin Lance needs a block, cuts it up inside the 20, chooks him into the 15, down to the 10, to the 5, to the 1 yard line goes Alvin Lance. First and goal, Appalachian.
Wake's offense, on the other hand, was lackluster in the first half, due in large part to a stingy Mountaineer defense that allowed only 18 yards in total offense in quarters one and two.
Made very few mistakes, either mentally or physically, on both sides of the ball. And I think the fact that the defense played so well in giving the ball back to us quickly, and then that we were striking with big plays and then scoring points and possessing the ball, led to kind of a shocking halftime score, and probably one that shocked us in the dressing room as much as anything.
The Deacons made adjustments at the half and began a furious rally led by quarterback Brian Kuklik and receiver Marlon Estes. But the Mountaineers were able to put the clamp on the Deacons with a blocked field goal and a defensive stand on Wake's final possession. It was a great win for the Mountaineers, but the seeds of a championship are not sown in August, but rather in the wintry months of January and February, watered and fed in spring practice, cultivated in the summer, and harvested in the fall.
With the work ethic of our kids over the summer, we had over 70-plus kids stay up here over the summer. We had a great spring practice. We had a great fall. We knew we had a chance to win the Southern Conference.
We was very committed. We was up here early in the summer. Everybody worked hard. And during winter workouts, we had to get up at 6:30 in the morning, it's something that carried over.
The fruits of the harvest were but the first ingredients in this recipe for success. Add to the mixture a beefy front line, coupled with bulls for backs, throw in a dash of spice for good measure, and the stew thickens, but lacks something. You have to balance it with a sandwich or two, and of course there is nothing wrong with a little cherry picking. Now while this sounds nothing like a culinary delight, it makes one heck of a football team. Week two presented a different challenge in many ways. One, the Mountaineers had moved up in national rankings from number 6 to number 2, a spot they would hold for 12 weeks. Secondly, they needed to maintain the momentum created by the win over Wake and prevent a letdown versus Division 2, Edinburgh.
Handed off, Damon Scott running right side inside the 5, down to the 1, into the end zone for the touchdown.
After Damon's 11-yard touchdown scamper, it was clear that the Mountaineers would answer the call. It was another banner day for the running game, this time rolling up 315 yards on the turf.
Looking to throw the football. Now he'll look to tuck it under some pressure. He'll still roll to his right. Looking downfield, cuts it up across the 45. And down to the 40-yard line, breaks a tackle, still on his feet. Down to the 35, spins forward, still on his feet. Breaks out of the 30, down to the 20, down to the 15, to the 10, to the 5. Touchdown, Gerard Hardy.
But it would be nothing like what the Mountaineers would be able to accomplish the following week versus Division I AA intrastate rival North Carolina A&T.
Right outside the side, they offset the eye to the left. It's off with Lance and Damon Scott, and Damon gets the call up the middle, trying to pick his way. Now bounces it outside. He's got room in midfield. 45, 40, 35, 30, and down to the 24-yard line goes Damon Scott. On first and goal to the 8, center field delay, handoff, David Scott dances around, takes it inside the 5, takes on a tackler at the 1, and falls into the end zone for the Mountaineers score with 5:13 to play.
Damon Scott, the junior from Cedar Grove, North Carolina, etched his name in the Appalachian record book with 228 yards rushing, the 8th best performance by a back in Mountaineer history. As a team, the Mountaineers were able to compile 409 yards on the ground. This was also the beginning of what would become a trademark for Scott Satterfield and Damon Scott, the late pitch.
Second and 5, Sat with that option, right side, keeps it himself, now pitches it, Damon at the 10, down to the 5, still on his feet, gets to the 1-yard line, goes Damon Scott.
It's almost like one mind out there, you know. When I'm in the game, I can sort of, you know, figure out the things that Sat is going to do in certain situations, because we've been in some certain situations, you know, in high school. It's not, you know, the same level of competition and things like that, but you do sort of get a feel of what a person's going to do once you play with them for a while.
It is a kind of a special relationship. I think that when players know each other on a personal level, it helps you play together on the field. And I think, which is the case for this whole team, I think everybody on this team, you know, knows everybody else, and we hang out a lot together. And I think we're like, you know, if once you know that and you know everyone, you're going to play together on the field because you can trust the guy beside you and you know he's going to get the job done. And
Appalachian once again dominated the first half, only to see the lead dwindle in the second. But All-American Dexter Coakley stepped in and made two incredible stops to preserve the win.
Field third, very short. Inside handoff goes to Shaw. Coakley levels it behind the line of scrimmage. May have lost the yard. Fourth down. Fourth and short, eye backfield. They'll give it to Shaw again. Look at it. How about this? That's Dexter Coakley with two of the biggest plays of the day.
There's going to come a time in the game where 7-8 plays are going to decide the outcome of the game. And you never know when they're going to come as a coach or as a player. So you have to go hard every play. Those two plays that Dexter made were two of the greatest plays I've been around in my 16 years. Where he had to make the football play to stop the momentum of A&T, and he came through. His quickness and his explosiveness just came through, and it really was a joy to see him rise up and be successful on those plays.
The Mountaineers escaped with the victory and remained undefeated, but after this game, a ripple of controversy was beginning to spread throughout the receiving corps.
After the A&T game, we, as a group of receivers, we were very frustrated, you know, because we didn't get the ball very much at all. And that week of practice was, like, very frustrating because we played 3 weeks of football and we're not getting any passes. The receiver group hadn't scored any touchdowns. And we kind of feel not wanted right now, I guess.
So basically what we approach the receivers with, as long as we're going to dominate the football game in the line of scrimmage, because we have an outstanding offensive line, that we'll do that first. And that's been our forte, so to speak. And that the pass will be an integral part, but some games it may not be as integral as a receiver would like it to be, as an individual would like it to be. And much to their credit, I think they recognize that winning and the team concept preceded any personal goals or anything that they might have, and they all fell in line and did a good job. And later on, we had a lot of big pass plays.
After the receivers had a meeting with the coaches and got assurances that they were not only a valuable part of the team, but also that some adjustments would be made, they went back to work and waited their turn. They didn't have long to wait.
Satterfield on second down and 8. Turns, rolls to his left. Pump fakes. Look at the end zone. Otis Smith. Watch this. Otis there. Touchdown. Otis with a 28-yard TD reception from Scott Satterfield, set up perfectly by the pump fake. Second down and 9. Scott, straight drop back of a 5-stepper, looks deep down the left-hand side, has a man open. Burton makes a grab at the 40.
But even with the improved passing game, the Mountaineers found themselves down by 10 midway through the third quarter. But some great play calling kept the winning streak alive.
They go with the power eye. Big Frank Leatherwood is in. Kareem Young is in. And Carlos Horton, two tight ends. Third and one from the six. Centerfield turns, makes the pitch. Looks in the end zone. Bomber! Touchdown! How about that call?
Great call.
We knew that their defense was a flowing type defense, and if you give them a fake one way, then they're going to flow, and they did, and it was just a quick hitter. I faked to the right, and Bomber slipped out right into the middle of the end zone, and he was wide open. I just hit him. Their defense just flowed out there, and they can't recover once they're out of there.
This play was a harbinger of things to come for the Mountaineers. It was a promising sign that good fortune was on their side, and that they could win with the game on the line.
We get the ball the most, you know, we're a running team. You know, it's very demanding. We have to take care of the ball. As our coaches said, we carry their money.
In week five, the running game reemerged behind a familiar face. And a not so familiar one.
Right side, one to the left, and Hardy's going to run out to the wide side, gets a block from his fullback, cuts it back, has a hole across midfield, inside the 45, 40, 35, 30, 25, breaks a tackle at the 20, still on his feet, and down to the 16-yard line, first and 10, Mountaineer. The turn and run option to the wide side. Gerard fakes a pitch, keeps it himself across the 45, across midfield, inside the 40, the 35, across the 30, down to the 25, 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown, Gerard Hardy scores! From 62 yards out.
Gerard Hardy got the call just moments before kickoff because Scott Satterfield went down with an injury.
It was an ankle and a knee, really, against East Tennessee State. And the ankle, you got pretty well got it cleared up from, and then it was a knee that kept reoccurring about it. But we, and then, you know, of course, we don't do anything on Friday, except when we got down there Friday, I watched him a little bit, and he was a little bit stiff. And I attributed it to the bus ride. I thought that's what it was. We just never really seemed to loosen up out there Friday afternoon. And I said, well, we'll just wait till tomorrow. We'll wait till pregame and make a decision then.
The offensive performance was not the only impressive one on the afternoon. The defense was fired up as well, recording a team record 11 sacks on the day and picking off two passes.
Our D-line and our pressure people and our perimeter people, backers and strong safety, did a good job changing things up and keeping them off balance, particularly the first half. I don't think they knew where we were coming from the first half.
The defensive unit right now is one. We don't have no really individuals on our team. We all work together, and when you work together, it makes a good defensive effort, and that's what we're just trying to do around here. We're trying to be the best that we can. Do the best of our ability. If it's one person making a great play or it's the whole defense, we usually try to get everybody to the ball, and that's our main goal. And if everybody's to the ball, we're winning a lot of games, and the defense is playing real well.
Week six. The Mountaineers return to Boone to face their toughest conference test of the season against 13th-ranked Georgia Southern and their flexbone ball control style of offense.
We stuck to our game plan, and everything happened and turned out good for us. I think our defense played a great game that game because it's tough shut down their offense. And I think we only got seven possessions as an offensive team, and we capitalized on just about every possession. So I think we did a great job in executing that game.
And they got a little help from an old friend, Luck.
Satterfield's in the shotgun with Scott and Lance in to protect. Scott turns, retreats, looks, fires it over the middle. It is picked off. And fumble. That ball's a free ball. Who recovers it? Jeff Ballmer does. Touchdown, Mountaineers. Scott Satterfield better walk over and kiss Jeff Ballmer.
Once again, the running game was clicking, rolling up 264 yards on the ground.
To me, this offensive line that I run behind now, I think is one of the best in the country by far. You know, it's been, we started out when I got here my freshman year. They were all young, and, you know, we got beat around, you know, by a lot of people. But now we've been together for 2 or 3 years, and things are starting to come through for us, you know. The line, they just doing a great job, pass protection, blocking. And you can tell those guys have been playing together for a long time because they just, it's almost like they can read each other's minds, too, you know, when teams running stunts and stuff like that, and they just pick it up great for us.
With the game on the line, the defense rose up and made great plays.
Mountaineers come in blitz again. Robinson over the middle. Dawson. There's Slot. Picks it off. Clarence got it at the goal line. Clarence breaks a tackle up to the 12-yard line. That will seal the victory as Clarence Sutton comes up with the INT.
It was no time to celebrate, though. The win over the Eagles set up the game of the year between the second-ranked Mountaineers and the third-ranked Thundering Herd of Marshall in Huntington, West Virginia.
Marshall was a game where we felt like they did not give us much respect for our win the year before. They felt like because they had people hurt on offense and those type things, that's the only reason we won the football game. So we felt like the Marshall game was a big game, and we knew it was going to be a real high-powered, high-intensity football game.
Going into the game, they said it was going to be a big defensive struggle, and I really didn't think so, us giving up so many points earlier in the year. But it was a great time for our defense to show up, and been going into the game, it was such a big rivalry with Marshall anyway, being number two in the nation and Marshall being number three up at their place. We really wanted to get a win out of it.
The intensity of the ball game. The hitting of the football game.
Pennington turns, rolls to his left, all kinds of time in the end zone, fires it out. Martin, incomplete. Boy, his head was taken off by Clarence Sutton.
Those things come to mind, Steve.
As a captain, I walked, me, Sean, and Tony Perry walked out of the locker room at Marshall, walking down that sideline, and we looked up and saw, 26,000 people in the stands, and it was a television game. And then we're all walking down the sideline, and we look up and we see that the Appalachian fans that are at that game on our side, and they all stand up and cheer us when we're coming in. And that feeling right there is something I'll never forget.
Fields in the gun, third and seven, retreats, four down linemen rushing over the middle. Alwyn makes the grab to the 42-yard line of the Mountaineers. First and 10, Appalachian. First and 10 for the Mountaineer 10-yard line. Iback goes for Centerfield on first down. Inside handoff all with Lance. Cuts across the 15. Still on his feet. 20. Breaking tackles. 25. Still on his feet. He's on the 35. 40. 45. Midfield. Down to the Marshall 46-yard line. He's got a heart of Phoenicia Stadium.
Both Appalachian and Marshall came in averaging more than 34 points a game. The Herd was compiling 434 yards in total offense, while the Mountaineers were averaging 384 yards in total offense. But by the end of the first half, neither team had scored, although they had their chances. Jamie Coleman blocked this Tim Openlander kick. And then Openlander saw this one sail wide left. Jay Sutton finally put Appalachian on top with a 22-yard effort in the third quarter. Just as quickly, Marshall answered with a 41-yard field goal with 9.5 minutes to play in the game. With the score knotted at 3, Ruffin McNeil's defense came up with one play after another and then turned the tide with this play.
Third down and 2 for the Herd. One wide out to the left with ball to the 43-yard line. They'll give it to Parker up the middle. Fumble. Ball's loose on the turf. Who got it? Appalachian got it. First and 10 at the Herd 44-yard line.
To make a big play in that kind of environment, it's very exciting. It's something that doesn't come around very often. And, I got a little excited, showed a little enthusiasm.
That was the break the Mountaineers needed, and they took full advantage of it.
Our basic belly type option where we pull a guard, and as I was coming out, the linebacker that the guard's supposed to cut was flowed out more so than they normally do, and Sean Clark ran out and cut him, and I saw a crease back behind that, and I just cut right behind Clark's block, and the guy got a hand on my foot, but put my hand down and just dove for the end zone, trying to get the ball across there, and luckily the ball got across the line, and he said touchdown. And that was pretty exciting for all of us to get on the board with the touchdown. Actually, the winning score for us It was really exciting.
I can't say enough about Satterfield. He's one of the gutsiest football players maybe I've ever been around in my whole coaching career. You know, when he scored, he had dinged his ankle about three or four plays before that, and just I kept pointing at him, and he'd turn his head away. I mean, I was thinking about putting Hardy in there, and he just a great example to young people.
Week 8 will go down as one of the saddest of the season. At home against UT Chattanooga, the game started out nicely for Appalachian.
Four wideouts of this pattern, and he'll drop back to his 33. Sends Alwin out of the backfield, firing it out. Otis Smith is wide open at the 25-20, 15-10, 5. Otis, touchdown, Mountaineers!
Satterfield on second and goal from the 6. Scott, turn, delay to Damon, wide open, down to the 3. Takes on a blocker to the 1, leans in, crosses the line. It's a touchdown for the Mountaineers, who lead it 16-0.
But it ended in tragedy. On this 2nd and 10 for the Moccasins, All-American Matt Stevens took a hit and blew out his knee. Lying on the ground, he was forced to contemplate what had most certainly been a promising future.
The last second, I tried to jump and I didn't make it. And he hit my knee and I felt 2 pops. And I knew it was over then. Just basically, why me? You know, I've worked hard to get where I'm at, and end of the season, at the end of the game, come on, blow my knee, and I was basically thinking that my football career might be over.
The Mountaineers posted the win over the Moccasins, but left the field that day with a heavy heart and wondering if their luck had run out. Week 9 began with a couple of questions. One was, how do you replace an All-American? The answer was Elando Johnson, who got some needed encouragement from his fallen teammate.
Well, I was told, you know, just don't worry about anybody else's job, just do his own job, and he can play at this level without, you know, having to worry about it, because, I mean, he covers receivers. He covers our receivers every day in practice, and, I mean, we have some of the finest receivers in the conference, so, I mean, it's really no different. I mean, all that we do at corner here at App State is cover receivers, I mean, so... I mean, that's all he had to do, just worry about his own job and cover. I mean, he can do that. So I just told him, have a good attitude and be a little bit cocky and everything's going to be fine.
Secondly, how do you stop the league's best rusher, Thomas Haskins? The only answer the Mountaineers could muster was constant defensive pressure and score more points than he did. That seemed to work pretty well as Appalachian was able to take a lead in the first half.
Satterfield in the shotgun retreats back to the 28, looking all kinds of time. Now Satterfield turns, rolls to his right, had Alwin Lance in front of him, but he said he fires it down to Clyde Everett. He'll make the grab at the 9-yard line. Behind him, they'll turn, give the inside handoff. Alwin, who'll walk into the end zone for the Mountaineers, score as Appalachian takes their first lead of the ballgame.
But for the second year in a row, the Keydets put a scare into the Mountaineers.
White outs on the side. Turn, delay, Haskins has the first down to the 40, 35, 30, 25, 20, 15, 10, 5, touchdown. Thomas Haskins scores from 47 yards out. Now Lester gets the snap and retreats back. He's going to throw the football. Looking. Now he tucks it under. He'll run it to the 3. The Mountaineers stump him at the 3-yard line, and that'll be all to preserve the 2-point lead.
And with that play, Appalachian was able to salvage the win, keep their record unblemished. Week 10 versus rival Western Carolina in a battle for the old Mountain Jug. There were obvious concerns entering this ball game. It had been a decade of dominance for the Mountaineers over the Catamounts. Would that and Appalachian's number 2 ranking be enough to motivate Steve Hodgins' team in this one? Well, those fears were allayed early.
Mountaineers take their first offensive possession in Western Carolina territory now at the 49-yard line. An eye backfield on first down. Scott turns, rolls to his right. Now he'll throw the football. Looking down the middle for Otis. Otis is at the 15, at the 10, 5, touchdown! How about that on first down, Steve Brown?
For this day belonged to number 43. Damon Scott became only the 5th Mountaineer to rush for 1,000 yards in a season. He finished out the year with the 2nd highest single season total in Appalachian history.
That's a great accomplishment. You know, it's something
you know, that any running backs wants to do at any level, you know, go for the 1,000-yard mark. But, you know, I want to give my hat off to my offensive linemen who made the whole thing possible for me, because, you know, without them, none of it is possible. But all year they have been opening holes, and I've just been running behind their blocking.
Back it down, they'll turn, pitch it left side. Damon, inside to 30, 25, 20, foot race, 10, 5, touchdown, B. Scott scores!
The goal of an outright Southern Conference championship was clearly in sight with this win, and as the pressure to keep it going mounted, so did the support. In fact, reminiscent of the Chicago Bears Super Bowl shuffle, local radio DJs Jim Jernigan, Jason Forbes, and Bill Fisher hopped on the bandwagon with all this right. Far from a chart topper tune.
All right. Well, the Mountaineers are winning. Yes, the boys are undefeated. Kicking butt. Yes, they're going to the playoffs. Gonna give them all a beating. Well, I talked to Terry Moore, and the head coach said,
hey, we're headed into the playoffs, and we're fired up.
Yeah! The other team said, we don't know what to do, because there ain't no stopping ASU. Can I get a witness?
Yeah.
Well, we beat up on the Deacons, and we whipped up on the herd. Yeah, we kicked around the Keydets and them Georgia Southern Birds.
Turkey.
Bunch of turkeys.
Yeah.
And then Ruffin McNeil of the defense, he said,
Hey, Dexter, you got to get to that out. You got to get to that number five out there just like 23.
Huh? What'd he say? What'd he say? There ain't no stopping ASU. Yeah.
You
feel
good, Billy Ray.
There ain't no stopping ASU.
You and your mama, too.
That's it. Because there ain't no stopping ASU.
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 Hey. Marshall's a girl. ASU.
McNeese, what?
What? McNeese, who?
McNeese. Hey, that sausage.
Hey, McNeese.
It's Apple.
McNeese has been hurting lately. I think it's going to rain.
My niece is the sister of my nephew.
Hey, Jim Dunn, bite this, buddy.
Week 11. Final game of the regular season on the road at the Citadel. There were too many parallels to draw with the previous year's disaster with VMI. Southern Conference title on the line. Playing a winless military school that would like nothing better than to topple a national power in the final game of the year. But the mettle of a man must always be tested. And so it was in this crucial game.
Tight end to the left, second and 13. Satterfield, three-step drop, rolls to his right. Now pressure, throws it deep down the middle of the field into traffic. Otis Smith goes high and comes down with it. That's a big-time kick there by Otis.
Shotgun to the 25. Looks, fires over the middle. Otis makes the grab. Beats his guy to the corner. To the 5, to the 1, to the end zone for a touchdown. Otis Smith scores from 15 yards out.
The Mountaineers were able to establish a 21-10 lead in the third quarter. A seemingly safe lead against a ball control wishbone team. But the Bulldogs got some lucky bounces and stung Appalachian with a score to take the lead with 10 minutes to go in the game.
That was tough because I feel like I never want to let Coach Moore, our offensive staff, and our defensive staff down. And with me calling defensive signals, I felt like I let the team down. I really did, to be honest with you, because we were playing pretty good. And you know, we know with the wishbone offense, you have to be very assignment-oriented. And, you know, I really felt badly for our team and felt badly for our staff. And I didn't want to lose the football game.
With a perfect season in the balance, the Mountaineers didn't flinch, didn't fold, didn't die. They fought.
Scott Satterfield gets to show his wares as a passer now. 2-1 out to either side, first and 10 for the 16. He retreats to his 7. Over the middle, it is caught. Otis Smith at the 35, dancing around, following to the 41-yard line. Goes Otis. That is a gain of 22 and a Mountaineer first down. Again, four down lineman rush, Satterfield over the middle, finds Allman, who has the first down, takes the ball to the 44-yard line of the Citadel. That'll stop the clock, and the Citadel shows blitz. They back out of it now, four down lineman rushing, looking, Satterfield over the middle, Otis has it, 26, makes the tackler miss, gets to the corner, hang on to that football, Otis, does throw the 27-yard line, first and 10 for the Mountaineers there. First and 10 of the Citadel 27 for Centerfield. Shotgun. He's under some pressure. Now he'll roll to his right, being pressured. Looking downfield, tuck it under. He's taking a tackle. Should have gotten out of bounds.
Should have gotten out of bounds.
Calls the timeout with 1:46 to play in the Citadel leading.
We was all huddled up there over there talking and everything. Coach Moore came in the huddle and said, hey, you know, we're all right. All we need is 3 points. You know, we're in good field goal. We need 3 points. And Ron Gillum said, you know, we're going to get a touchdown. I said, yeah, that's right. We're going to get a touchdown.
Yeah, initially, I'm thinking, hey, you know, I don't want to mess this up. But then I felt like that it's funny in football. Things tend to happen the way they've been happening. And the Citadel players were 0-7 in the conference, and we were 7-0. And they had struggled all year and lost close ball games. We had won close ball games. So I think you could see it as every play we made, their sideline kind of said, oh no, here it goes. Our sideline said, here we go. And I think you could kind of feel that and sense that. And as players, I think they sense that. And it's a little bit like that shark smelling that blood. Once they smell that, I think it's going to happen.
Two wide outs go to either side. Satterfield in the shotgun formation. Citadel coming with a blitz. Here they come right up the middle. Scott retreats. Looks. Throws it deep in the end zone. Has Ron Gillum there. Gillum! Ron! He got it! Yes! Ron Gillum with a big catch! It's a touchdown! 1:39 to go!
We just talked about the blitz happening. Great job by Rob Best. Excellent throw by Satterfield. And Gillum's got to get a lot of credit. He got double teamed and split the double team. Touchdown Mountaineers.
He laid out for it. 1:39 to play.
Well, I mean, it probably makes it sweeter, but it's too nerve-wracking for us and the fans and everybody else. But it does make it a sweet victory to come back and win the game within the last minute. So
I feel good. I kind of been waiting on this a long time in my career because I played DB here 3 years, and they recruited me as a receiver. And I guess I just still had the love for being a receiver. But I went to coach last year at the end of the year. Things didn't go too well for me as DB. I made the transition. It took me a while to learn the offense and get the hang of things, but now I just feel great, and it's just down the road from here.
You know, they're just a gritty group of men. We talked last night. We talked again this morning what they're going to be, what those men are going to be, what they're going to be like 10, 15, 20 years from now. And I think today is evident of what they're made out of. They're just a special group.
Well, being a North Carolinian, native North Carolinian, it really was satisfying to me. Because not only did we do something that no other team in Appalachian State had done, but we did something that no other team in the history of North Carolina had done. And I guess I identify with that more because I'm from North Carolina, and I know the tradition of North Carolina and its athletics and sports. But it was really satisfying to be able to go out and do something no one else has ever done, to have a perfect season.
And I don't think anybody can imagine how much pressure we had on us to win. But it was a great feeling to know that I was a quarterback of 11-0 regular season team, which, you know, is just unbelievable in itself. And especially for me to come up here as a walk-on and to have the things that happened to me here is unbelievable. I never would imagine in a million years. And to have, you know, the community and the chancellor, everybody backing us. We had a pep rally on Monday after practice one afternoon, which, you know, I don't think that's probably ever happened. We're out here practicing, and they're having people are gathering over here, to congratulate us and to, you know, to help us continue to win. And it was just a great feeling and a great thing for Appalachian State University.
From there, it was on to postseason play. In week 12, Appalachian welcomed James Madison to Kid Brewer Stadium. The Dukes featured a high-powered passing game, gassed by a brash young quarterback. The Mountaineers got their game in gear midway through the first half.
It's in motion out of the backfield. They'll turn, pitch it right side. Damon inside the 30, 25. He gets to the secondary at the 15, 10, 5, touchdown. D. Scott scores for the Mountaineers.
The old saying is, you dance with who brung you. Appalachian's dance card was filled with Damon Scott's name. He rushed for 196 yards and had his third three-touchdown game of the season as Appalachian advanced to the second round for the second consecutive year. In week 13, the Lumberjacks of Stephen F. Austin came calling. After taking an initial lead, the Mountaineers fell behind later on in the first quarter, only to regain the lead again in the third quarter.
First and 10, Satt going to throw the football. Burton's open over the middle. Instead, it's Avery. Klein to the 25, makes the grab to the 19. First and 10 for the Mountaineers at the Stephen F. Austin 19-yard line. Third and goal for the Mountaineers. And the Stephen F. 6, here comes the play. Scott unloads it over the middle. Alwyn, he got it. Did he get it? Touchdown, Mountaineers, 6:42 to play. Third quarter, and Appalachian leads 16-13.
But now, it was becoming clear that the victory march was about to stop, and the Mountaineers would be left standing still. The final chapter had been written prematurely, and it was a sad ending to a magical season. It was the most successful season ever in Appalachian history. It was the first team in North Carolina to finish the regular season undefeated in the modern era. It was the first Southern Conference team to ever win 8 league games. The team also featured 13 all-conference performers, 4 first-team All-Americans, and the inaugural winner of the Buck Buchanan Award for the best 1AA defensive player of the year, in Dexter Coakley. The 1995 football year will be remembered in a variety of ways. Great games, great plays, great fans, great players, and real people with great hearts.